It is time for question time to the Minister for Regional Development, and I call Mr. Oliver McMullen.
Question one.
My department and the Department of Finance and Personnel approved a business case for this project in 2015. The project is complex and includes a number of elements. Firstly, it aims to replace TransLink's existing ticketing equipment, which is at the end of its useful life. Secondly, to update existing concessionary and TransLink smart cards to align with new technology, particularly online card top-ups. Currently, this is only available on rail services. To put this in context, there are currently 500,000 smart card holders. Thirdly, to expand ways customers can use retail channels to purchase and top up travel cards or use mobile technology to a greater extent. Finally, to facilitate off-bus ticketing on Belfast Rapid Transit. Technical and customer-led enhancements planned include ticket vending machines and more tickets sold off vehicle, stored value mobile cards, online top-ups and gates which will automatically validate smart cards in Northern Ireland. Consultation has taken place with other transport operators here in Great Britain and Europe. Some of the key benefits expected include improved bus boarding times, reduced use of cash, improved data and communication channels, and also improved customer choice. The procurement phase of the project started in early 2015. The invite to tender issued to a number of interested suppliers in December, and full implementation will take a number of years to complete, but initial developments will be rolled out from 2018. The system will be developed with suppliers and must be feasible and affordable with income maintained.
Well, Mr. McMullen for supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for that comprehensive reply? Minister, when you say the initial rollout will be 2018, are we looking at the programme being rolled out in 2018, or is it coming in, is it going to be phased in? Basically, what we want to know are a time frame for implementation so the public will know exactly when it's going to happen.
Okay, thank the member for his supplementary question. I can advise at this stage that, subject to a successful procurement, the award of the contract is expected to be complete by the end of 2016. The design of systems will run up to the end of 2017. Ticketing equipment replacement will begin during 2018, and full implementation with enhancements could run into the early part of the next decade. And the project will align, obviously, then with the timetable for Belfast Rapid Transit, which includes off-bus ticketing. But I can say that the advice that we've been given, because of how complex it actually is, that it is probably better to phase this in. So I hope that gives an adequate response.
Well, Mr. Trevor Clark.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and can I also thank the Minister for a very detailed answer to the question. Given that answer, Minister, and you did talk about the technology and the difficulty of implementation and the challenges that would be afforded to that, can you give us an indication, or give the House an indication, of how many or who will have been consulted in relation to this system?
Again, I thank the member for his question, and it is quite a comprehensive list, and TransLink have consulted widely with other transport operators and authorities on the mainland, in Ireland and Europe. That includes Transport for London, Transport for Greater Manchester, National Transport Authority in the Republic of Ireland, Transport for Edinburgh. They've had engagement with the ticketing system supply industry, engagement with financial services suppliers, that includes MasterCard, Visa and various banks. Also consulted with local stakeholders, including, for example, the Consumer Council, Northern Ireland, the Education Authority and Tourism Northern Ireland, and also had qualitative and quantitative consumer research with customers and focus groups across Northern Ireland, and that includes around 2,000 face-to-face surveys. They've issued a comprehensive document with the following organisations responding: IMTAC, the Consumer Commissioner for Older People for Northern Ireland, Northern Ireland Environment Link, Belfast City Council, Sustrans, Western Health and Social Care Trust, Armagh City, Banbridge and Craigavon Borough Council. A meeting has also occurred with the Education Authority transport officers for each respective region, and that occurred in June 2015. And TransLink is also fully involved, the CCNI, in complying with the surveys for the ticketing customer survey exercise and reviewing the subsequent, subsequently produced report. Thank you.
Mr. Sean Roger.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thanks, Minister, for your answers. Minister, when do you expect to get a final report on the integrated transport, including community transport?
Discussions are obviously ongoing, and obviously community transport is something which is beneficial to all of our constituencies, particularly the rural constituencies. And I was delighted that we were able to get additional funding in order for to help that particular group, and also in association with DARD to do that. With regards to integrated ticketing with the rural transport, that's something which actually is causing them some concern, particularly around their budget. But discussions will always continue with that lobby.
Call Mr. Raymond McCartney.
Good morning, Prevost. Last concluder question ever though. Question number two, please.
The money next section of the A6 is included in the Randallstown to Castle Dawson dual carriageway project. This scheme comprises two distinct sections of dual carriageway located either side of the A6 Tomb bypass. A 4.5-mile stretch from the end of the M22 to the eastern end of the Tomb bypass, and a 4.2-mile stretch from the western end of the Tomb bypass to the existing Castle Dawson roundabout. When completed, this scheme will significantly improve connectivity between Londonderry and the wider North West region and Belfast. I'd previously announced that funding had been provided to progress the A6 Randallstown to Castle Dawson scheme to an advanced position, so be ready to commence construction at short notice should the necessary funding become available. In May 2015, as part of this process, Graham Farren's joint venture was appointed to assist Transport NI and its consultant advisors with the development work, which is currently ongoing. Yesterday, as the member will be aware, I announced that the allocations for the A6 set out in Minister Foster's budget statement of December 2015 will enable construction of this scheme to commence in the next financial year. This is good news for the Northern Ireland construction industry and also those using the road, and work on site is expected to start by the end of the summer.
Mr. McCartney for a supplementary.
Robert Preve, last concluder, August Gwyn Bwegas, Leshen, Eiriton, Regis, August Gudisho. Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for both her answer and indeed the announcement which she made yesterday. This question perhaps a bit out of date, but I think it is welcome news, and indeed I think if she heard the commentary this morning, and I heard Cathal Washing and the Chair Trevor Clark being asked, and I think that the date is very important, and I think when the Minister has the opportunity, if I can offer this advice, to give people a precise date, or you'll have all the sceptics forever questioning the thing, but this is a very welcome decision. So can the Minister have, or does she have any certainty for a starting date?
We're obviously hoping that this is going to happen within the start of the summer, but it's obviously very much dependent on budgets moving forward and the next minister. But my commitment is certainly that we move forward with this and do it as quickly as possible. As you say, that it has been very well received, and I know there are sceptics out there, and there are also critics around design and so on, but it is something which has been long waited for, and I hope that we are in a position in the summer that this can be commenced.
Well, Mr. Ian McCrae.
Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her announcement of the £130 million, I believe, project. Whilst I leave it to my colleague to refer to the Randallstown section, certainly welcome the the Castle Dawson to Toome section, but as a driver I have to say it's something that's long overdue. Can the Minister, while she has referred to the start date, can the Minister give us a timeline of how long she believes that this project will take to get its completion, and certainly join with me, and I certainly join with her in agreeing that this is certainly something that will benefit both not only my constituency but my colleague Trevor Clark's constituency, as well as other road users in Northern Ireland.
I thank the member for his comments, and obviously I've met with the member on a number of occasions in relation to this and other schemes within in the area. As I've said, the construction is intended to start around the summer of this year, and with a fair wind, completion should be then around 2019.
Mr. John Donald.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I thank the Minister for her reply and wish her well in her job. The Minister is far too young, of course, to know that the first houses demolished around Dungiven for a bypass was more than 50 years ago. The Minister therefore will realise why we have sceptics, and could she give us some indication when our two cities, Belfast and Derry, will at least have a roadway that's off dual carriageway to enable the North West to participate fully as equal partners in economic growth?
I thank the member for his question, and I am too young, thankfully, to remember that. Again, I have had a discussion with Mr. Dallet in relation to the critical connectivity that's needed between Londonderry and Belfast. And as he is aware from those conversations, that I see the A6 as critical to that. And I hope that will see fruition in the not too distant future, but it's something which I regard as a priority.
Mrs. Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, or Principal Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for that. Indeed, I'm sure the people of Mid-Ulster will welcome the news that the A6 is progressing to yet another stage, and I hope that the remainder of the money is forthcoming in the next financial year. And I welcome the responses to all the questions so far. Does the Minister foresee any problems, or how does she foresee the problems when the project is taking place, to daily commuters or for daily commuters along the A6 while the project is underway?
Thank the member for her question, and obviously there's something particularly for a local member, something of concern, but I think if we can reflect back on as a project, the A26 as it's ongoing, and how well that has actually been managed. So I would assume that should be that the lessons that have been learnt from the A26, which have been successful, can then be carried through across this project. So, but again, this is something which we seen as something which is a risk which needs to be managed.
Well, Mr. Chris Hazard.
Question number three.
My department has not incurred any financial penalties as a result of environmental pollution offences in the last 5 years. Northern Ireland Water has, however, incurred financial penalties as a result of environmental pollution offences in the last 5 years, and these amount to £61,250. This figure equates to £16,250 for 2011, £22,500 for 2012, £7,950 for 2013, £9,300 for 2014, and £5,250 for 2015. These figures show a marked reduction in the amount of fines from 2011-12 to 2015, and reflect the hard work undertaken by Northern Ireland Water. Northern Ireland Water has steadily improved its environmental compliance over the past number of years. This level of improvement has led to Northern Ireland Water achieving the best ever wastewater compliance in recent years. That's 98.4% in 2014. And this can be attributed to significant investment in sewage services and improvements to the management and operation of the wastewater assets. In order to achieve this, Northern Ireland Water has developed and implemented a pollution reduction strategy to minimise the risk of prosecution cases arising. The strategy is centred on the three areas of operational management, capital investment, and education and awareness. The delivery of identified actions stemming from this strategy has been linked to the steady improvement on the number of pollution incidents attributed to NIW.
Hazard for supplementary.
Coyle, I thank the Minister for her answer thus far, and it is indeed to be welcomed that we are seeing less incidences of the need for these sort of fines. We do, however, still have a situation in some places, such as Ballyhornan. The department are pumping a level of sewage into the water at Ballyhornan that they would not do in other places of the north. Will the Minister give a commitment to make 2016 the year that this ceases? Cormugad.
Thank the member for his question and obviously his remarks in relation to this, and I would like to think that isn't going to be the case, and certainly that if that is that any debris and any that is cleared up very quickly, and that we don't then lead to an environmental issue which then becomes much more difficult then to contain.
Well, Mr. Gordon Lyons.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer. It's good to hear that there has been additional investment which has helped to reduce instances of environmental pollution. Can the Minister inform the House or give an assessment of the current state of the drainage infrastructure in towns and cities across Northern Ireland and how that infrastructure fared during the recent heavy rain?
Thank the member for his question. In most Northern Ireland towns and cities, there are sections of the sewage network that do require investment to reduce the risk of sewer flooding and to improve combined sewer overflows that are causing pollution. Northern Ireland's Water's PC15 business plan states that it requires £185 million of capital investment to address this by 2021, excluding Belfast and treatment works across Northern Ireland. However, due to public expenditure constraints, less than 50% of that could be funded in the utility regulator's PC15 final determination. Significant investment is also required by Transport NI and Rivers Agency in order to improve drainage infrastructure. Just in relation to the recent flooding, obviously Northern Ireland Water was part of the interagency cooperation efforts responding to the general funding situation around Upper and Lower Lough Erne. The company has been involved in regular conference calls with other responders, including PSNI, the Fire Service, Transport NI, Ambulance, and also work in conjunction with the local councils. Northern Ireland Water reviewed the resilience of the Killyhevelin Water Treatment Plant following the 2009 flooding in Fermanagh. The subsequent flood resilience construction works were completed in 2011-12. Northern Ireland Water has invested £600,000 in a number of measures at the site, including construction of an earthen levee, installation of additional storm pumping sensors and alarms, and the scheme was specifically designed to provide protection to the treatment works during flood conditions. It was evident from the discussions which I had during the period of the flooding, and also the meeting which we held last week, that this was successful and made a difficult situation less difficult.
Can I remind the Minister about the two-minute rule? Call Mr Adrian Cochrane-Watson.
Principal Deputy Speaker, may I thank the Minister for her answer? And I would just wonder, would the Minister be in a position today or maybe in the near future to share with the House where these financial penalties have been incurred by Northern Ireland Water? I'm particularly concerned with the 6 mile waterway in South Antrim. But I fully appreciate if the Minister wants to come back to me on that.
To share that information, and I have it here, and it's something which I can make available to the member.
Call Mr. Basil McRae.
Question number 4.
In dealing with flags on street furniture, my department's primary consideration is in its duty of care for the safety of the public, employees, and contractors. Where unauthorised flags pose a hazard to road users, my department will seek to remove that danger. When there is no such danger, my department acts in accordance with the multi-agency joint protocol in relation to the display of flags in public areas, which was introduced in 2005. My department is generally not perceived to be the lead agency under the protocol. In most cases, other signatories such as the PSNI, OFM-DFM, the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, DSD or DOE are better placed to assume the lead role in arranging for the removal of flags through their contacts with community groups, local elected representatives and other relevant contacts. Under the protocol, when called upon by the lead agency, my department provides the access equipment and resources to remove unwanted flags once agreement has been reached for the removal and where they are not easily accessible. As I've said, my department has a duty of care to its staff, and in situations where flags need to be removed, the safety of personnel tasked with the removal work must always be taken into account.
Mr. McRae for a supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm glad that the Minister referred to the 2005 protocol. But let me ask her a specific question about legislation. Is she aware that, according to the Police Service of Northern Ireland, that if they attempt to take down flags of whatever nature from a lamppost, that they are actually creating trespass? There is a legal impediment. How does her department deal with the legal issue of trespass for the PSNI in following out the protocol under 2005?
Obviously, thank the member for his question. And I know that the member is spending some considerable time actually looking at this and looking at a possible amendment to legislation and so on. I'm happy to have a discussion with the member in relation to this that particular point. And if you would like to liaise with my office, I'm happy to discuss that with him.
Call Ms. Claire Hannah.
Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answers to date. I would agree with others that the flags protocol is being widely ignored in many places. In my own constituency, paramilitary flags fly on many lampposts, including on main thoroughfares, although I would share your view that the DRD aren't probably the appropriate lead agency on that, but in the absence of a regulatory framework, they are in charge. Could you comment on last month my colleague, Councillor Declan Boyle, was ordered to remove posters he'd erected on lampposts relating to a spate of burglaries, and those were ordered to be immediately taken down, and why the same prompt action isn't taken about flags, particularly paramilitary flags?
I thank the member for her answer or for her question, and obviously she'll understand that the removal of flags and so on is quite complex and requires a lot of community negotiation around the sensitivities around that. Obviously, the issue that she raises in relation to her colleague's posters would fall under the advertising section within the legislation, which goes beyond flags. And obviously, an assessment would have been taken at that stage in relation to that particular aspect. And it would deem that there wouldn't have been any issue in relation to intimidation and so on to my staff. I know that sounds probably quite a complex answer, and perhaps even more lawfully answered, if I'm going to be fair. But it is within the remit of my department in order to be able to do that.
Mr. Chris Little.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister to confirm that there is no way to obtain lawful authority to display flags on street furniture owned by her department, and to explain, therefore, why she has taken no action to deal with flags on street furniture owned by DRD, or to report that to other agencies that she has suggested should be lead agencies on that issue? And if she is going to say that community consultation is required, could she explain there why she has not undertaken community consultation on an issue which surveys consistently find around approximately 80% of people surveyed do not believe that lampposts are indeed respectful places from which to display a flag of any colour?
thank the member for his question in relation to this. And as he knows, as he's aware, there is no provision under the Roads Northern Ireland Order in 1993 to give the department the powers to issue licences to place flags. So it is regarded as illegal. But that makes it quite what he's asking me to do is essentially to take the lead in relation to this. He will be aware that under the Fresh Start Agreement that a Flags Commission is being established. Those discussions will be had around another table, which will obviously be then go out to consultation, which is probably the appropriate place for to have that.
Well, Mr. Cackaloshin.
Question 5.
Thank the member for his question, and with your permission, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to group questions number 5 and number 9. There are currently proposals to construct a dual carriageway on the two sections of the A6, these being from the end of the M22 at Randallstown to Castle Dawson and from Londonderry to Dungiven. I'd previously announced the funding had been provided to progress the A6 Randallstown to Castle Dawson dual carriageway project to an advanced position, so it would be ready to commence construction at short notice should the necessary funding become available. In May 2015, as part of this process, a Graham Farns joint venture was appointed to assist Transport NI and its consultant advisor with the development work, which is currently ongoing. Yesterday, as I've said, I announced that the allocations for the A6 set out in Minister Foster's budget will enable construction to commence within the next financial year. The A6 Londonderry to Dungiven scheme is well advanced in terms of development. It has been through public inquiry in 2012, and the inspector has produced a report embracing various recommendations, some relating to complex issues. My officials have prepared a report addressing the recommendations arising from the public inquiry and are currently reviewing the extent of this scheme, which can be built with the funding allocations in the December 2015 budget statement. Once I've received these reports and considered them in full, I will make a decision on how the scheme should proceed.
Mr. O'Shea for a supplementary.
I thank the Minister for her statement and her answer. And I'm on record as welcoming the announcement that she made yesterday in terms of the tomb section. But the Minister will be aware that the public inquiry into the A6 Dungiven to Drumahoe section closed in October 2012. We're now into our fourth year. Is there any reason why this has been delayed for that period of time?
Question. Yes, the public inquiries into the scheme were held, as he says, in late 2012, and the inspectors delivered his report to the department in March 2013. One of the inspector's recommendations was that an alternative route for the bypass of Dungiven be considered in sufficient detail to allow an informed comparison to be made between it and my department's published route. Transport NI's project consultant subsequently reviewed the alternative route and its findings endorsed my department's published route. However, there was a view that this was not sufficiently independent and may not have given the alternative route a fair consideration. So an independent review of the alternative route was commissioned by my department, and this has now been completed. Reports have been prepared outlining the findings of the review and addressing the other recommendations arising from the public inquiry. Once I've received these reports, and I haven't as yet, and once I then get that opportunity, then I'll consider them in full, and I'll make a decision on how the scheme should proceed after that.
Oh, Mrs. Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for the detail this afternoon on the A26. But can the Minister confirm that her department has been working with the landowners along the A6 and the Moneyneck to Castle Dawson area, and that she or her department has been able to find satisfactory resolutions with all the farming businesses in that area?
Thank the member for a question, and I've asked exactly the same question, and I understand that there has been good cooperation in resolving some issues which may have come up. Again, that's something that I will continue to ask, and certainly, as with other schemes, Just when you start a scheme doesn't necessarily mean that that the discussions are concluded, and they will continue throughout the process.
Time is up. We must now move to topical questions for the Minister. I call Mrs. Dolores Kelly.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I congratulate the Minister on her appointment also? And I know the Minister and I have been speaking over recent days in relation to the flooding incidents, and I trust that the Minister will support my colleagues Colm Eastwood and Mark Hedgedark in relation to support for businesses which had been very adversely affected in the executive meeting later today. But Minister, perhaps you could outline the specific role that your department is responsible for in response to the immediate aftermath and experience of those caught up in the floods, particularly rural dwellers who rely heavily upon septic tanks, and also what steps your department and initiatives you will be showing in the coming weeks.
I thank the member for a question, and indeed I have had discussions with Mrs. Kelly over the last number of weeks, in particular around her own constituency. But in general, my department has worked very well as part of the multi-agency approach to dealing with the current flood situation, together with Rivers Agency, councils and other responders. And really at this stage, I really do want to pay tribute to the work of all those staff who have been involved in trying to alleviate some of the pain which has been felt by those who have been left stranded, and also are, I'm sure, very weary after this, what's been a very long process, given the rainfall that we've had, and the levels didn't ever seem to be ceasing to go down, but thankfully today we can see a significant change in that. With regards to sort of my key priority has always been about making sure that roads are safe and where possible that they are kept open. Immediately, we will be looking at remedial work that needs to be carried out on those roads which have been flooded, and we'll be able to get a better assessment of that once the water has subsided. As well as carrying out emergency repairs, obviously we'll be looking forward to looking to longer term measures and identifying where structural maintenance is really required in those roads in and around Fermanagh and Upper Ban and in other areas. The member has mentioned septic tanks, and obviously this is something which Northern Ireland Water will give support to, and particularly reminding, I think it is important that you remind people that they are entitled to have a removal of sludge once a year, so it's incumbent upon all members to make that known, and also with regards to the council's role with all of this as well, around the emergency payments.
Well, Mrs. Kelly for a supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer. I would ask if the Minister would give some instructions perhaps to NIW to look at a second clearing, because that is a real problem in some septic tanks which people are very worried about, if that would be the case. And further, in moving forward and looking at the amalgamation of departments in the next mandate, if the Minister would agree with me that there needs to be greater collaboration. I know that I have attended many site meetings where there's the blame game. Rivers Agency blames roads and roads blames, and we never get anything done. So perhaps you would look specifically at some of those areas, and I will write about those in my constituency which have been part of that blame game, and if you would have a particular focus in any assessment and evaluation of the last number of weeks and how it has played out in rural areas in particular.
Number four question, and indeed I think it's been reflective upon how the good working that there has been over the last number of weeks. But you know, I have, as a constituency MLA, I've also hit the same problem, and I think that as we move forward in the Department of Infrastructure, I would imagine that should be much easier to deal with, and that those agencies will work much closer together. In some ways, perhaps this is a lesson learned of good practice in moving forward, and we can also see how that has worked out with working alongside local councils as well. Her suggestion in relation to the second clearing, that may be something that that could be considered given what's happened in recent weeks, but I'll certainly pass that on to Northern Ireland Water for their comment.
Mr. Stephen.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Could I ask the Minister whether, in relation to the sale of Kernwood and Ballysally Reservoir by NI Water, whether there's been any expressions of interest, and if she can provide detail to the nature of that interest, the type of commercial opportunity?
Okay, if thank the member for his question, and in relation to Ballysalla and Cairn Wood, as he's aware, this is one of 26 impounding reservoirs which are owned by Northern Ireland Water but have been regarded as surplus to use, and they are obliged then to put them for sale. Having gone through the normal processes of discussions with other government agencies and statutory bodies, and them not actually giving any expression of interest, then that's been moved to the open market. Obviously, it's all part of the commercial life, and I understand that there are interested bidders, and I believe that they hope to close that sale within the coming weeks. As to their long-term plans for that, that's something obviously which they will want to do, will want to explore themselves and the viability around whatever they intend to do with it. But obviously they will be restricted with regards to the forest area as well.
Mr. New for a supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm very grateful to the Minister for her answer. She'll be aware that there has been great concern in the community about access to the forestry, and indeed protection of the forestry, and indeed access to the site in general. What reassurance can she give to my constituents and beyond in relation to continuing public access and protection and conservation of the site?
Thank the member for his question, and I know that even from my own constituency borders very closely to this facility. Dard Forestry Service own and manage the trees in this area, so while anyone purchasing that land would own the land, the trees are still in the possession of Dard. And so the same arrangements which are currently with Northern Ireland Water would then continue with the new owner, and they would be obliged then to comply with Dard's deforestation policies. But with regards to access, again, that's something which probably need to be explored. But I'm happy to meet with the member to discuss any of these issues.
Question 3 has been withdrawn. I call Ms. Megan Farrell.
I'll ask Ken Corlin, and want to initially offer the Minister congratulations on her new role. I don't believe I've had the opportunity to do so yet. But can I ask the Minister to provide an outline of what the current procedure is for the clearance of roadside gullies?
Thank the member for her question. During 2015, Transport NI aimed to inspect and clean gullies once during the year. Additional inspections and cleanings, I believe, were carried out if there were known problem areas, and they were based on a very much a reactive basis.
Fair and first supplementary.
Thank the Minister for her answer. Can I ask, is the practice of leaving removed materials to the side still pertinent, and does it pose a further risk to safety on our roads given recent flooding?
Thank the member for her supplementary, and if she's aware of that happening in particular areas, if she'd let my office know, and I can ensure that doesn't happen, particularly if it does cause a risk to drivers or to pedestrians.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. I wonder, can the Minister provide an update on her key priorities within the Mid Ulster constituency?
I thank the member for her question, and obviously there was an announcement made yesterday which was in the Mid Ulster constituency, which of course is deemed very much a priority, and we've also got the Macrofelt bypass is ongoing and progressing particularly well. There will of course be maybe perhaps smaller schemes which are being worked on, and certainly if the member has a particular issue that she wants to highlight, I'm quite happy to hear that.
Ms. Overend for a supplementary.
Thank you very much, and thank the Minister for that response, and appreciate the work that's been put into Mid Ulster thus far, but going forward we need to keep progressing and looking to see how we can make improvements within the constituency of Mid Ulster, and we have access to the constituency of Mid Ulster is now improving with the A6, etc. But we need to ensure a good flow of traffic within Mid Ulster, considering that 27.5% of jobs within Mid Ulster are within the manufacturing industry. And that's compared to 11% of Northern Ireland overall. It's really important that we ensure the flow of traffic. Would the Minister consider upgrading the importance of the A29? From a link corridor to a key transport corridor, within her priorities.
Thank the member for her question, and obviously traffic flow really throughout Northern Ireland is incredibly important, and given the statistics which she shared in relation to manufacturing, those links to the ports are doubly important. Certainly with regards to the A29, I'm happy to have a discussion with officials and get back to the member.
Well, Mr. Barry McIntosh.
Goramayagut, Alias Ken Corlia. Given the recent allocation of funding to the A5 project, the announcement coming through the Fresh Start Agreement, can the Minister give assurance that there will be significant progress on the A5 dual carriageway project in 2016?
I thank the member for his question, and as he's indicated, it was a critical part of the Fresh Start programme, and obviously additional money was secured from the Irish government as a contribution towards the A5. An outline programme identifying the next steps is actually currently being developed. In this House, I had given a commitment that I would speak to land agents who would be affected by the A5. I have honoured that. I've had the meeting with them prior to the Christmas break. They raised a number of issues which I'm currently looking at as well. The anticipated new environmental statement and a new draft strategy, statutory orders, are going to be published shortly, and further information will be available in relation to that.
For a supplementary.
Okay, thank you, Deputy Speaker. Thank the Minister for her answer, her comprehensive answer. The Minister does say that the draft orders will be signed off, hopefully, shortly. But could I ask the Minister to be more definitive, more specific, in relation to the timeline for signing off the draft orders to enable the project to move to the next stage?
I'm hopeful that I'll have an announcement to make before the end of January in relation to this. Obviously, the first section is for new buildings to north of Strabane, which is where the money has been identified for. So that is obviously my focus at present, and we'll be moving forward on that. But I'll be giving more detail towards the end of the month.
Well, Mr. Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, you'll be aware that the A26 Lisnevna Road has been the scene of a number of serious and fatal accidents in the past, and your department is undertaking a review of the safety measures on that road. Could you provide an update as to how that project is being progressed?
I thank the member for his question. As part of its annual review of collision sites, Transport NI is currently carrying out that review. It's from Ballee to Dunsilly. It's expected to be completed within the coming weeks, and T and I will then take forward any appropriate remedial measures in relation to that review.
Mr. Swan for supplementary.
I thank the Minister for that. Minister, would you be willing to have a meeting in regard to any future proposals that come forward, especially in regards to the Wood Green junctions and junctions of Crumkill, which have been the scene of a number of serious accidents recently?
Thank you, and the member for his question. Don't really want to comment on particular accidents, but I am content to have a meeting on the back of that review and to discuss those measures with the member.
Call Mr. Alex Maskey.
Can I ask the minister? Could the minister provide an assessment of the work ahead to address the issue of coastal erosion?
Thank the member for his. His question. Obviously, as a representative of a coastal constituency, I'm very much aware of the effects of coastal erosion and the need for better coastal management. The problem is not coastal erosion itself, rather than how we approach our response to it. At present, there is a somewhat fragmented approach which sees different departments and local councils exercise different responsibilities. As a result of that, and in full awareness of that, as you'll be aware, I called together a number of stakeholders, including the Minister of the Environment, and the Chief Executive of Rivers Agency attended on behalf of the Agriculture Minister, along with representatives of the National Trust and councils which are locally affected by coastal erosion. This proved to be a very positive forum, and it's something which I feel it can be built on. I plan to have another meeting of that forum in February. it's very difficult at this stage then to set out a programme of work, given the fact that we are moving into a changed departments. But I think it's something which is a really good basis to move forward. And I know that there have been critics of it and feeling that it hasn't gone far enough, but I've only been in this role a very short time. At least I'm taking initiative and being seen to do something.
Time is up.